was always his own person and a little bit different.
He stood out because of his sense of humor and audacity.
Always right on the edge of going too far.
Persiguen una meta implacablemente.
Brian was a very determined individual, very smart.
He wanted to see how far he could take it.
If it repulsed you, that was just as good as if it made you happy.
Sus luchas.
I think what led to him becoming Marilyn Manson was probably Heritage Christian School.
Y reveses.
Everybody hated us. Nobody wanted to sign us.
Algunas personas nacen inspiradas.
Someday I want to grow up to be a rock star.
Un chico callado y desadaptado se convierte en el rockero de impacto más temido de América.
He was just a normal, sweet child.
I'm gonna punch you in the f***ing teeth.
There would be nudity.
Girls in cages.
You know, he cut himself open pretty good sometimes.
Imágenes, historias y revelaciones nunca antes vistas de las personas que saben lo que realmente sucedió porque lo vivieron con él.
We were like bisexual, satanic, drug addicts.
People are getting totally the wrong message here about Brian.
Esto es Driven, Marilyn Manson. Vive Marilyn Manson.
Brian was born in January of 1969. He was a very quiet little boy, a lot like his mother. I think he looks a lot like his father, but I see a lot of his mother's shyness in him. He was the type of child that if he walked into a room and there were a lot of people, he would hide behind his mother and then slowly come out. If someone had said to me that one of these children is going to be a famous rock star, Brian would have been the last one I would have chosen.
Ladies and gentlemen, Marilyn Manson!
He grew up in Canton, Ohio.
It's in the Midwest, so it's a fairly conservative town.
Canton's kind of a boring little town. There's not a whole lot. Football is big.
We have the Pro Football Hall of Fame.
That's our big claim to fame.
When I first met Brian, he was pretty small, he kind of freckly-faced kid, brown hair, pretty scrawny.
I know he got made fun of a lot. I guess it was what they call a nerd.
Brian and I played midget league football in 1981 for the Spartans. I was number 28, Brian was number 41. Brian was a receiver. As a receiver, you wouldn't get much action.
He never really liked the whole sports thing.
Brian didn't really have a lot of friends. He wouldn't leave the house all too often. He stayed at home a lot, watched TV, would draw, would write.
His grandpa and grandmother on his mother's side lived right next door to him in the duplex, so he got a lot of attention from his family.
He was an only child.
So he got pretty much whatever he wanted.
Brian's mom was very sweet, very wonderful, excellent mother, little of June, you know, Cleaver there, but hipper.
He was raised on, you know, cartoons and cereal and Coca-Cola, the Smurfs.
Brian's main motivations were probably just entertainment.
We used to create these characters out of clay, but we'd put all of the body parts inside. And our big project then is to operate on them and take all the organs out and change them. And that was a big one for a while.
Brian had a very active imagination.
It's basic kid stuff that, you know, we'd be fascinated with, like, you know, burps, you know, any kind of, you know, bowel movements, anything to that effect.
I remember him telling me that he really liked eating Superman ice cream. It had, I guess that kind of ice cream had a lot of different colors in it or something, because he said when he went to the bathroom, everything came out purple, and he just thought that was pretty cool.
Las semillas de la rebelión.
Brian started Heritage Christian in second grade, and he went through the 10th grade.
It was a typical parochial school. It was private.
And the school is very right-wing conservative, had a lot of Baptist upbringing and teachings. We had Bible class once a day, and then weekly we had chapel.
We would bring in different speakers or some local ministers or something.
Definitely with a lot of fear factor, was definitely held fire and brimstone.
The speakers were pretty much targeted to try and convince us of, like, the evil ways of the outside world. There was a lot of evangelical type language. Come down front. Stand up in front of your peers and show them you're not afraid. Brian has such a thirst for knowledge. He stood out because of his sense of humor and because of his audacity at times. A few times when he would try to participate, bring up a topic in class, he'd just get shot down immediately. And I could tell that really bothered him.
Brian definitely liked to push people's buttons. He was witty and fun, but always right on the edge of going too far.
in his Bible study class, he'd share with me that he'd write 666 and things like that on the books. It's not like he'd worship the devil, but he'd write things on there just to get a rise out of his teachers. And it worked. He'd get reprimanded for it.
Well, we were really into Mad Magazine and Cracked Magazine because we loved that sense of humor. And so we decided to do our own magazine and sell it to kids at school who didn't have much access to that kind of stuff. And by the end of the day, he had been called into the principal's office, gotten spanked. He'd never second-guess himself, just incredibly driven as far as if there's something he wants to do, he goes after it.
Mazmorras y Dragones.
Brian was never into anything halfway. He pushes everything he can to the limit. Dungeons & Dragons was definitely Brian's biggest interest.
Everything about Dungeons & Dragons we had to know and devour.
We spent, maybe like a week straight one time playing. I mean, we took breaks to go home and go to sleep and eat meals, and we'd come back first thing in the morning and start playing again. His parents bought him hundreds and hundreds of pewter miniatures, and he would hand paint all of those. He was so creative when we would play. He would always add some spin to it above and beyond what the rules were in the book.
We started to get rhetoric coming out of some of the teachers and in chapel about how Dungeons & Dragons could lead to all sorts of depravity. And so that's when there was a really sharp clampdown on some of the activities that the students were doing.
We actually had to sign a contract, an agreement, that we wouldn't drink, we wouldn't do drugs, we wouldn't cuss, we wouldn't listen to rock and roll music. And they spent an awful lot of time trying to teach the kids not about religion, but instead about why rock music is going to rot your brain.
Yeah, Brian liked hard rock music, so right away he was the devil.
We listened to a lot of the larger-than-life bands at that time. Ozzy Osbourne, Black Sabbath, and Judas Priest. He was a huge Kiss fan. His father and mother took him to concerts even. His dad even got dressed up with him a few times in all the makeup. He had every Kiss record, every Kiss makeup kit, radio, you name it.
Brian would be painting his face up like the members of Kiss, and he'd come to the house, and then he'd ask for himself. And we thought that he was one of the members of Kiss asking for him, like he was really important. He'd have the little blood capsule in his mouth and he'd break it, and he was really into that kind of thing.
He seemed to draw energy from the dark side of the music.
He drew an Iron Maiden album cover on the concrete wall and
Vive Marilyn Manson. Saliendo a la luz pública.
He didn't fit in with Wild Heritage Christian School.
I remember him many times talking to his parents, like wanting to go to public school. I have to get out of there. A couple months into 10th grade, Brian ended up leaving, and his parents sent him to the local high school nearby.
When he came to Glen Oak, he was at a disadvantage because, all the other kids had grown up and had gone through all these classes at all the other schools together. So he was kind of odd man out.
I think he always felt like he was a little different.
He never associated himself with any certain group.
He didn't neatly fit into any of the stereotypes that we know of from those years in high school, being a burnout or a jock.
I think Brian had a lot of trouble relating to the other kids because he was more intelligent.
He really started to excel in his writing classes. He was a bit of a Renaissance man. He dabbled in a lot of things, poetry, he painted, he drew.
There was a drawing that was kind of scary looking, to be honest with you. I couldn't believe they printed it in the yearbook on the same page with apples and the koala bear. It just didn't fit. It just looked somewhat satanic.
What I remember most about Brian, I guess, is his year-round tan.
Dermatologists recommended that he use a tanning bed because it helped dry up his complexion.
He was insecure about his face.
He'd crimp a lot with his hair. It was a big thing about his hair. His hair had to look good.
He was really kind of obsessed with the way he looked.
Mama y papá.
His parents were real easygoing. He would go to his house and there was no rules whatsoever. His mom used to take us to the drive-thru and buy us beer.
Her opinion was, you're going to get your hands on it anyways. I'd rather that you were supervised while you're drinking than out there getting into trouble and maybe getting arrested by the cops.
His parents basically let him do whatever he wanted. His dad was pretty comical.
Well, Uncle Huey, he's got a warped personality. He'll say anything he can to shock you.
Never. Some of our friends would come around and meet Brian's dad for the first time. He always had a trick, perverted question he would ask you.
He'd look at you and just say, so, have you ever tasted a better pecker than mine?
either way you answered, you lost.
Anything to shock you. That's kind of the way Brian is.
Adios, Ohio.
He moved away the summer we graduated from high school.
His father got a job offer down in Florida.
Everybody knows Ohio's 10 years behind the times. So I think when he got to Florida, he did have a little bit of culture shock.
His plans were to go to college there for journalism.
He was a good writer. I think a big part of being a good writer is feeling it or having a love for it. And unquestionably, he had that. Brian's niche was to write entertainment stories.
He really concentrated on the progressive scene in South Florida, all of the local bands.
I would have liked him to get more involved with the student newspaper, but I knew that he was writing for one of the local papers.
25th Parallel was an arts and entertainment magazine that was geared primarily towards South Florida, sort of an alternative press kind of thing. He came to the interview and he had a lunchbox with him. Well, in the world I come from, people don't carry lunchboxes when they're in college. He would come up with these ideas for articles interviewing dominatrixes or waitresses who worked at topless restaurants. He had a real head for that sort of stuff. And as he improved, he moved on to things like celebrity interviews. He did an interview with Trent Reznor of Nine Inch Nails. He was just so enthused about meeting this person. At that time, his ultimate dream was to be Trent Reznor. And he was just so thrilled. Oh, I got along so well with him. Oh, yeah, we're best buddies. And I'm thinking in my mind, you know, I'm willing to bet money that Trent Reznor won't remember you like a week later.
Ser o no ser.
He started writing a lot more poetry at that time.
It was sort of bleak, unfriendly,
humorous with a dark undertone.
Punk rock without the sense of humor. They had open mic nights for poetry reading.
First time I saw Brian do an open mic, I heard him say, you know, I wrapped our love in foil, and so it wouldn't spoil, but flies will lay their eggs. Pretty heavy.
I think that just writing prose and poetry as expressions were not getting him the attention he wanted or expected.
Writers don't get instant gratification the way musicians do. That kind of got to him.
Let's be honest, you know, poetry is not as, doesn't come in as sexy a package as rock lyrics. The best way to get attention is to do it within rock.
A lot of the bands that he interviewed, they had something that people wanted to talk about.
Just kind of realized, hey, I've got as much talent and I've got things I want to say. Why am I on this side of the pencil? I think is what he started asking himself.
He came to me and he said, I'm going to start a band. I remember my reaction was, you got to be kidding.
He didn't play any instruments or wasn't musically inclined. I was the other half. I was musically inclined. So I needed a partner, basically. We would just talk on the phone and talk about crazy ideas as far as pop culture and serial killers and drugs and Saturday morning cartoons when we were kids. And we just started forming ideas as to like what kind of songs we would write, how we would dress. All the ideas came about before any of the music.
He had this idea of 50s pinup girls and serial killers and the dichotomy of both of them and kind of merging the two together.
And that's when the name Marilyn Manson came about.
And he actually showed me that MM, that logo, Marilyn Manson. And he says it was a culmination of Marilyn Monroe and Charles Manson, the good and the bad, the black and the white.
La difusión.
The promo started immediately.
We started putting out flyers just with our names on it. In upwards of 2 or 3 months before we had our first show.
We would just make up stickers and hand them to everybody we could, and we'd go around sticking on buildings, on stop signs.
And some were just really wrong. And each one would have something offensive to somebody.
He knew about self-promotion. He knew how to package it. At that time, I don't think he really cared too much about the product. He just wanted to sell it. He had asked if 25th Parallel could run an article about this band, Marilyn Manson and the Spooky Kids. And I didn't have a problem with it. I mean, I thought it was a little bit weird. Have you played anywhere yet? Well, no. Do you have a demo tape yet? Well, no. Yeah, sure, what the hell, go ahead. And we got an intern to interview him, and he asked me if he could rewrite it, and I'm like, sure, have fun.
Go ahead, make yourself look good. It was the first piece of press the Spooky Kids ever had.
It's hard to get a two-page full story, you know, about a band that's never even played a show.
He had written something along the lines of Marilyn Manson is going to take over the world and they don't care who they have to trample underfoot to get there. Pretty heady stuff considering that they hadn't played a note at that time.
I remember we were going to a creative writing class and he just told me, like, I don't think I'm going to come back. I want to do the band. He just quit and never really looked back.
A continuación, Marilyn Manson le muestra al sur de la Florida que es un verdadero hombre espectáculo.
They would do things with, like, chicken feet strung across the stage to girls in cages dripping, you know, chocolate sauce off their breasts.
Luego, MTV tiene un extraño encuentro con el futuro del rock de impacto.
We wanted Gail. I came here to marry her. She's not here, I'm sad.
Can I say? I hate to disappoint you, man.
Y después, la transformación de Manson es completa.
We needed to call him anything but Brian.
He liked to be called Mr. Manson. I always make sure that I call him Mr. Manson. I don't want to get him upset.
Driven, Marilyn Manson. Driven, Marilyn Manson.
I first ran into Brian Warner in the local music scene in South Florida. I heard about this crazy new band called Marilyn Manson and the Spooky Kids.
I was at their very first show at Churchill's, and they didn't even have a drummer then. I mean, they had a drum machine on a stool.
There was probably between 20 and 30 people.
And this tall, skinny, geeky kid singing.
And I just remember feeling embarrassed for him because he didn't make eye contact with the audience.
He hid behind the microphone a little bit.
You really had no image at that point.
People were like, the hell is this?
Half the time he'd be in the back throwing up because he definitely had some major stage fright. You know, we didn't even know if he'd be able to perform. It's kind of hard to sing when you have a throw up in your throat.
They had this kid playing bass. His name was Brian Tatunic.
Tatunic really didn't have that much to do with what we did. I mean, he played our first two shows with us. That's it. So we needed a bass player.
We used to see each other out of clubs a lot. So right off the bat, he knew I was this young, loud, and snotty punk kid that was just trouble. But he liked that. So he decided, you know, he should get me in the band with him. Me and him just became really good friends.
Brad really influenced Brian's appearance.
I looked like a cross between Divine from the John Waters films and Sid Vicious. He like latched onto that, started like asking me for makeup tips, started dressing like me, and he really kind of like took my image and evolved it into his thing.
It was all accredited to Brian because he was the one selling it.
He was probably one of the better, if not the best, self-promoters in Florida.
I used to see Brian outside every major show. You'd see him out there with flyers that he personally made, handing them out to people. Trent Reznor and a lot of people picked up on what the band was doing.
Trent said, it's really interesting. What the f*** is playing drums? Lo and behold, July 4th, we're opening for Nine Inch Nails. You know, there's just four of us, and one of us is just crawling around the stage. We don't have our s*** together at all.
La presentación.
The first time that I met Brian, my band Genitortures was playing, and we found out that our opening act for the night was the Spooky Kids. And I remember looking out on stage, and he was lighting his lunchbox on fire. Instantly, we became friends. Their performance at that time really was very cartoon-like.
His only shtick back then was just dressing crazy and having really inane props on stage.
I just remember really being struck by the Sid and Marty Croft feel of everything. They had the striped socks, blue fingernails, they carried their Lidsville lunchboxes.
People thought we were creepy and kind of kooky, but that was just our influences. You know, we grew up watching cartoons, you know, and Willy Wonka.
They took everything from your childhood that you remember from the 70s and brought it into a big nightmare. It was just a real trip.
He had an unbelievable following. He used to have these young girls with their lunch boxes at every one of his shows.
A lot of girls with blue fingernail polish, with strawberry shortcake lunch boxes, just following them around everywhere. Brian's parents, they're very supportive, showed up to his shows wearing t-shirts with his picture on it.
His dad was great.
I remember one of the shows, he was walking around with a priest collar, and he was just so proud.
When we started becoming more popular, he started getting better looking girlfriends.
He really loved the attention because I think he lacked getting attention before when he looked, you know, like a regular Joe.
Por la radio.
You know, Halloween is just around the corner, and as a special treat, I thought we'd meet some spooky kids.
I hosted a local music show on a local rock station. There was a big buzz about the band, and I wanted to get them on the show. And he gave me a cassette, and it had four songs on it. So I was listening to it, and then I got to My Monkey, and I absolutely loved it. I was like, wow, that's the one. I got to play this song. I was kind of waiting for some complaint calls to come in, and I never got one. All I got was, what was that? Who was that? Play that again. Brian was a very serious and determined individual, very smart.
He knew to get where he wanted to go, he had to be professional. Even when he was planning an outrageous stunt, he needed to do it right in order to get the full impact.
He asked me to videotape their shows. He would study them and, you know, see what went right, what went wrong. So I videotaped a lot of strange shows.
As we watched him and the band evolve, I watched it evolve into darker and darker regions.
They would do things with, like, chicken feet strung across the stage to girls in cages dripping, you know, chocolate sauce off their breasts.
There would be nudity, body piercing, lots of sexual innuendos.
We had this thing, we were like bisexual, satanic drug addicts, and we created that hype.
He had this whole elaborate stage show set up.
It was almost like cabaret. It just got so theatrical that you forgot about the music.
All of a sudden, I got it. It was vaudeville. It was sort of like Alice Cooper brought into the early 90s.
I think the vision was pretty complete from the start. He wanted to provoke people into thinking. Challenge the ideas of what a rock star was, challenge sexual ideas, religious ideas.
If it repulsed you, that was just as good as if it made you happy. It was just a lot of trial and error, and I think he finally just hit on the things that really touched people off.
He just wanted people to react, whether they reacted positively or negatively, as long as they had a reaction.
Representando a Marilyn.
6 months after our very first show, we started packing clubs.
We started getting bigger locally, so we had to find manager.
Early in 1990, when we first started playing out, John Tovar saw our very first show.
I remember walking in there, and after seeing two songs, I really couldn't stand them, so I walked up. 6 months later, my friend Glenn Richards told me that Manson was the most requested act at his show every Sunday. You should manage these guys. They're going to go somewhere. So I went. I showed up to the place. It was like midnight. There were 300 kids screaming, looking like him, like Manson. He had the aura of a rock star. To me, he was Morrison, Iggy, Bowie, and of course, Alice Cooper, rolling to one. I realized, I said, you know, if this guy can draw this amount of people with no record deal, this guy's going to be a superstar.
John Tovar and his partner, Frank Gallari, decided to sign us to their management company.
You know, I told him, I like what you're doing, and I think it's cool. I only have one small problem with you, though. You need a drummer really bad, because that drum machine is not happening. I think that was the first time the Manson listened to me. He went out and got himself a drummer.
I mean, it just brought a whole new dimension to the band. I mean, it just brought it alive.
He had some very good guidance from John Tovar and some other people, but I think he just took in everything. He absorbed everything that was going on around and sort of shot that back at us, 10 times more obnoxious.
I think he wanted to see how far he could go.
Manson had a mission. He wanted to get out of South Florida.
He's like, I'm going all the way. I mean, there was no way to stop him.
He knew he was going to be a rock star. There was no question, no doubt about it.
A continuación, el arte y la realidad chocan cuando Manson se asocia con su ídolo musical.
Trent rented the Sharon Tate house to put a studio in.
Here we are, Marilyn Manson, and we're recording where, you know, the Manson family killed some people.
Luego, un spooky kid descubre que Manson no admite la debilidad.
Basically, I got fired on Christmas Eve in rehab.
You either pull your way, or you'll be left behind.
Y después, la banda más impactante del rock recibe un trato menos estelar de la policía de Jacksonville.
Manson had a strap-on dildo as part of his act. And I guess they didn't really like that.
They arrested him.
Tribe en Marilyn Manson. Manson. La Caja Mágica.
Brian and Brad were on Hanging with MTV.
We were guests in the audience. We weren't popular then. We just wanted to go because Brian had a crush on one of the hosts.
I'm Gail Mirren, and if you're just joining us, you couldn't have picked a better time.
It was funny because we would dance for the songs. Two crazy, skinny white boys that can't dance. And they got the camera on us the whole time. For some reason, they zeroed in on us. And they come up to us. They're like, oh, where are you guys from?
You in New York for a while?
Yeah, we're here for 3 days. We're in a band, and we're doing a showcase tomorrow. So we're going to be on and
off. From Miami, sir?
Yeah, we're from Miami. Band's Marilyn Manson.
And he's like, oh, I came here to see, you know, the host, but I'm upset because she's not here today.
We wanted Gail. I came here to marry her. She's not here. I'm sad.
What can I say? I hate to disappoint you, man, but...
I had this picture of her that I...
Very cool. Now, well, you took this picture off the television?
Yeah.
That's very cool. Now, and, of course, she's here with us in spirit.
Such a nerd, you know, like, oh, little kid with a crush. We were just, like, fans, you know, and we wanted to be on MTV. We did interviews on cable access, whatever we could do to promote ourselves.
I am very, very pleased to welcome Marilyn Manson and the Spooky Kids. Guys, thanks a lot for being on the show tonight. Do you feel like you're writing music that kids are relating to?
It seems that the young kids are really, really relating to what I'm saying. I don't know why. I really don't want to analyze it, but I appreciate the fact that people understand where I'm coming from.
Algo por nada.
His dream was always to go national, was always to be signed, to leave Florida.
Marilyn Manson's struggle to get signed is almost a textbook case of what a local band will go through to get signed.
We talked to everyone from independent labels all the way up to Epic, Interscope, American Recording, Maverick, RCA.
Almost every record label you think of would come to see us play. And everybody hated us. Nobody wanted to sign us.
People were scared that it might have been too hard to promote him. Everybody would be like, oh, well, he's too satanic, he's too into drugs.
A lot of record labels got distracted by the theatrics.
We auditioned for Sony, and we went up to New York for a private showcase.
And the A&R guy comes up to us afterwards and said, they really like the band, but they don't like Brian. They think he's too pretentious and phony, so we're going to pass.
When the deal didn't go through with Sony, it was around the same time that Trent Reznor was starting his own record label.
I got a phone call from Manson, and he told me Interscope is going to give Trent his own label called Nothing Records, and Trent wants us to be the first signee on the label.
Trent decided to sign Brian because he knew he could break that band and make it succeed.
We were very happy to be signed, but I could just start to smell politics happening.
When we started to deal with the big boys and the labels, they felt that the name was too long.
It went from the band that Brian and I put together, which was Marilyn Manson and the Spooky Kids, to just Marilyn Manson.
It's the last Marilyn Manson and the Spooky Kids show, because we're changing our name officially to Marilyn Manson.
By dropping the Spooky Kids, then it was Marilyn the persona and Marilyn the band.
That's when, in his head, it became his band.
Retrato de una familia americana.
Trent flew us out to L.A.
He rented the Sharon Tate house to put a studio in, and that's where he wanted to put his record together.
Here we are, Marilyn Manson, and we're recording where, you know, the Manson family killed some people. Yeah, there's a good vibe going on in there.
The album's done, and Brian showed up and said, Interscope's going to drop us if we don't change this, that, and the other thing.
Some lyrics that Charles Manson wrote were incorporated in a song.
They didn't want my monkey on the album because of the ties to Charles Manson.
I could never really see, like, what the problem was. It was all a goof, you know, it was all tongue-in-cheek.
I know it upset Brian a lot. He was pretty adamant that he was going to find another distributor if he had to.
Thankfully, Trent Reznor really stuck his neck out for us and basically told him, well, you drop Marilyn Manson, you drop Nine Inch Nails.
Interscope gave in. I guess they saw something in the band. They didn't want to let it go.
Marilyn Mania.
They were promoting a Portrait of an American Family when I started working on the fan club. He was going on the road, so he asked me, would you take care of this for me? You know, we're getting some fan letters. I figured, just a couple hundred a month. But it turned out to be a couple of hundred letters every other day. Brian took the fan club seriously because he knew that that was going to be his army.
It seemed like it became kind of like a cult thing.
He loved it. His reaction to it was great. It's working. I have these people that, you know, want a part of me.
I was 5 when I first met him. He was rehearsing right next to my dad's studio. He asked me to be in the Lunchbox video.
He's speaking as a child. You know, someday I want to grow up and be a big rock star so no one f***s with me.
I thought it was pretty cool how he was different, and that's how I wanted to be.
He brings something to the Misfit kids, and he makes it okay for them to show their own look on life.
I saw real devotion on the road. I saw two young girls with Marilyn carved in their chest with a razor blade on one, and Manson in the others with blood dripping off of them.
There would be underage girls sending in nude pictures of themselves, saying that they wanted to marry him, that they wanted him to take their virginity, that they wanted to kill their family and join his.
Marilyn Manson's fans started just trying to emulate what he was. So the originality factor went out the window. It was no longer be yourself, it was be Marilyn Manson.
When we started getting really weird and creepy fan responses, my first thoughts were maybe we should do something. But then I quickly realized that you're not a therapist, you're a rock band. You can't get that close.
Manson generally cares for his fans.
A lot of people have a very, very wrong image of what this guy is about.
Look at me, because I'm going to punch you in the f***ing teeth.
He is very gentle and very kind to people.
Now, Brian was smart. He realized at that time that he is Marilyn Manson and Brian Warner. He could separate the two. He didn't have to be Marilyn Manson 24 hours a day like I was doing. I did all the drugs, slept with, you know, whatever, men, women, animals. I was living the image. You know, I was Gidget Gein.
Brad overdosed one night after a show, and Brian called me like 8 o'clock in the morning, upset that his friend might die.
Brian talked me into going to rehab. He's on the verge of tears. I'm feeling really bad, you know, that I let this guy down. I get a FedEx 2 days later. It's a letter from the lawyers, the managers. Basically, I got fired on Christmas Eve in rehab.
You either pull your way or you'll be left behind. And unfortunately, didn't live up to Manson's expectations.
When Brian had to finally kick Brad out of the band, it was very difficult for him because he really did care about him a lot.
You know, I still love the guy, and it hurts to know that I did that when they, like, depended on me.
Espiral descendente, momento ascendente.
When they went out on tour with Nine Inch Nails, that was huge.
Trent was very generous with Manson by offering Manson the opening spot on his tour in the fall of 1994.
Every show got bigger and bigger and better. And he got more fans. Even the fans that hated him loved him. Salt Lake City is a great town. Beautiful Mormons out there.
I'm in the hotel room and I get a call from management saying they don't want you to play tonight. They feel the band's offensive. The Mormon community doesn't want it. So they did everything to piss off whoever was not letting them play. The cap to it all was Manson actually on stage with Nine Inch Nails ripping up a Mormon Bible. It caused a lot of havoc.
I don't think Manson realized the impact it was going to have.
That's the first time I ever saw any protest.
What built this band was controversy, and Brian knowing how to use that to his advantage.
He was able to figure out that bad press was good press, and by giving people something to talk about or write about, it would make him more popular.
God f*** your ratchets!
We played the Coliseum in Jacksonville.
Jacksonville's a very hard line Christian right town.
As Marilyn Manson was playing, the stage was surrounded by police officers waiting for him to make the wrong move.
Manson had a strap-on dildo as part of his act, and I guess they didn't really like that.
They arrested him. He got arrested for dropping his drawers and massaging a very large phallus, and I wrote an article about it. I got a phone call, and the first thing I hear is, you better not print my name.
That seemed to be like a big deal to him, his name being released for the first time.
It would blow the whole image.
That was more of a problem than the actual arrest.
He made a veiled threat, something about my well-being. It's funny to think that the only time I've really had a death threat was from a guy wearing stockings.
A continuación, en su primera gira como espectáculo principal, Marilyn lleva el pandemonium a un nuevo nivel.
He cut himself open pretty good sometimes, and it'd be scary.
Y luego, el sueño hecho realidad de Marilyn se convierte en la peor pesadilla de los padres.
There was no doubt this video was gonna just piss off mothers across America.
Vive Marilyn Manson. Vive Marilyn Manson. Gente bella.
The major change I saw in Marilyn Manson was when we first played in Los Angeles.
We were the house band at Universal for like a week. And so every night it was basically just a wild party. You'd just see Perry Farrell, Gene Simmons, Ron Jeremy, Tracy Lords.
They just hit it off like they were supposed to be together, and they ended up going out. At a show in L.A., you don't need a backstage pass because everyone is important. The song Beautiful People came from that experience. He wanted to be a part of that scene, I think. He fit in very well with Los Angeles.
He looked me up when he was opening for Nine Inch Nails. You know, and at that point, it was already getting a little awkward or weird to have a conversation with him. I mean, how do you relate to someone who's doing what he's doing?
As things start to snowball and you become more popular, you start to build up an insulation between yourself and everybody else.
He didn't like to be called Brian in front of the fans.
He would get very annoyed if in public people call him, "Hey, Brian."
We needed to call him anything but Brian.
He liked to be called Mr. Manson. I always make sure that I call him Mr. Manson. I didn't want to get him upset.
Somewhere along the line, he became Mr. Manson full-time.
It was a year on the road with Nails, and then Manson started right away with his headlining tour. And I think that is, you know, really when the crowd got to be introduced to Marilyn Manson.
Something crazy happened every night.
He'd be breaking bottles and cutting his chest open.
When Brian started cutting himself on stage, I thought, okay, probably won't do that again because he's been whining about it all night, you know, after the show. And then he would do it even more at the next show.
You know, he cut himself open pretty good sometimes, and it'd be scary.
Barb, his mom, she freaked out. She didn't like that at all.
Erizando plumas.
Some fan brought us a chicken.
So they decided to put the chicken in a cage on stage. Somehow the cage got kicked, the chicken went into the audience.
Next thing you know, it hits the fan. Word's gotten out that Manson is sacrificing animals.
The chicken never died, but somehow PETA and SPCA got a hold of this news that Marilyn Manson was sacrificing chickens.
As the tour would go on, the legend of sacrificing chickens grew and grew, and then we would get to venues and there'd be cops there, or there'd be a lineup of f***ing people reading everybody the riot act before shows.
Unfortunately, I think he's gotten a lot of negative publicity that's not necessarily due him.
The media puts this bad spin on him, saying he's a bad influence on kids.
I could not believe that an entire country got so up in arms about this scrawny kid in plastic pants.
Dulces Sueños, Éxito.
They weren't getting their album pushed by the record label. Any recognition was from concert touring. They didn't get any real airplay.
I mean, they hadn't really had a big single. And then all of a sudden, Sweet Dreams.
It's the first time you sing it, you're like, wow, that's going to be a hit. Brought a whole different meaning and tone to it than the original Eurythmics song.
I mean, he just reinvented the song. It became their song.
Everybody. great shtick where the lights go out and you have this big construction worker's light bulb. You know, he's singing into the light and then right as the song gets heavy and kicks in, he's bam.
And the crowd loved it.
The first I worked with Marilyn was on the Sweet Dreams video. With this video, it was just about creating absurd images that bordered on the surreal. Really didn't need any explanation other than, what did I just see? What is that? There was no doubt this video was gonna just piss off mothers across America, you know? MTV making that a buzz clip was a huge significance. The thing was on like 6 times a day, hypnotizing children across America.
I think that's where they really made an impression on the country.
Everybody loved it. He became a household name after that.
He's being played on the radio, and he's got a great video to match. And awesome, boom, there he is everywhere.
That was the mainstreaming of, you know, the Marilyn Manson image. Just, it blew up like that.
In the very beginning, I would say that Marilyn Manson was maybe a repressed personality somewhere deep in the mind of Brian Warner.
He wanted to be accepted but didn't know where to fit in, so he made his own path, basically.
Is Marilyn Manson a real person?
That's the old question. Is it all an act?
No, it's not all an act. It's all real. I mean, Brian doesn't make separation between being a character on stage and being a person in front of you.
You know, he developed the character of Marilyn Manson, and then he became that character.
I suppose that Marilyn Manson just took over Brian Warner. Don't know that Brian Warner exists anymore.
Encuentre biografías, videoclips, fotografías y más de todos los artistas de Driven en VH1.com.